friend of Sonny, member of the jazz community of New York. This number is called a yukata. It's Japanese. It's called the yukata. And I'm wearing it for Sonny Fortune. Sonny and I met in the early 70s. I'd come back from Amsterdam. He'd come in from L.A. And we met at slums. It was great friendship. I mean, it got to be, we talked every afternoon. And those of you that know Sonny Fortune well will understand when I say, before I called him, I checked my clock. Because Sonny could keep you on the phone for a long time, more than Luke Donaldson. Anyway, in the 70s, late 70s, Sonny went to Japan on the tour with McCoy Tyner and thought about me and brought me back my first Japanese garment because he knew I was into the Japan culture. And it was the yukata. That was back in the late 70s, so it's gone now. But this is from when I lived in Tokyo, back in the 90s. This is my neighborhood in Tokyo. And I wore this tonight because I remember Sonny gave me my first. So, this is Sonny Fortune. Which takes me to the first speaker. The last time I saw Sonny Fortune was at the club Smoke, where he was ill to the point that he did not come off the stage. He sat on the stage on a chair. Myself and many other musicians asked, Sonny, do you want me to help you off and help you back? He says, no, I'll stay. That was hard-headed Sonny Fortune. Hey, you know that, huh? Well, the next speaker is a guy who stood out because he came from Philadelphia to take his dad to the gig and take him home after the gig. Dwayne Fortune.
Seen him, I guess, start from the beginning and come over here and started working with McCoy and Alvin Jones and you name it. I think he went out to the West Coast and was working with Buddy Rich, you know. Worked with countless people, Miles Davis, you know. I mean, he really made a name for himself, you know, in the music world, you know. And it just came from hard work, you know. And I don't know if he knows it or not, but he kind of told me to work hard, you know, and then provide for my children. You know, he was a good provider, you know. I think I mentioned this in Philly, how when Christmas time came, and me and my sister would get all these toys, we wondered where they get the money from. He told me this a little later on in life that he said, man, you know, we were going dead. You know, we get those toys and we get out of debt probably by June. And we go back in debt, you know, to get the, you know, to get this year's toys. So, I mean, the guy was really always a workaholic type of guy. I mean, just never really quit, you know. I'm a Mr. Guy, I'll tell you. I mean, he just had a lot to give, you know, like Bob was saying. He kind of stole my mind, though, but I would say this, too. Whenever I would call him, I would tell people, look, I may talk to you tomorrow because I'm calling Dad tonight. Because, you know, he talked a lot, and when I called him, it might be hours, you know. Sometimes, I mean, as he got older, I would fall asleep, and he wouldn't even know me. when he was a little young, he would catch me, though. But yeah, he liked to talk, I mean, he loved to talk, you know, he really did. And he always had something positive to give, you know, some real good input. He always amazed me of the knowledge he had about a lot of things. I mean, politics, when he got started about politics, you know, in today's world, he could really go on. He didn't like what was going on around right now. He said to me, he says, you know, it's so full of, I can't cuss, but it's so full of, y'all can imagine, everybody got to wear glasses now, you know, he says, you know, it's just a mess out here right now, you know. You know, he just really was an amazing guy, I can tell you. I mean, me and Steve was talking about him sometimes and how he would be passionate about his points, you know. And, you know, a lot of times if you didn't exactly agree with his points, you sit back and listen, you know, because if you kind of spoke out, then it would be another conversation, you know. So, but the guy was, I mean, for him to be the age he was still up and running, you know, and I guess moving on to when he got sick, the night that I came to Smokes and I took him home, I kind of noticed something. I noticed he was kind of slowing down last summer. He had a cabinet on him throughout the whole summer. That he started in the Atlanta part of June. And he was trying to get the cabinet off of him. He went back a couple of times. He had a seizure. Get the cabinet off. That didn't work out. He had to keep it on a little longer. I would say about in August or was it September, he was going to get the cabinet off of him. Again, hopefully that would have been the time that it would have came off. I think it was September the 20th, if I'm not mistaken. It was on a Thursday. He never really made it to that appointment, you know. So between that Tuesday and that Thursday, fell out and had a stroke, you know, and I had talked to him that Tuesday, and I told him I would call him Thursday night to see how he made out with the catheter, and then when he got a hold of him Thursday night, but I didn't really think too much of it. I figured he was resting, maybe got the catheter off, I'm trying to be positive. She called back Friday, he didn't get a hold of him. Started getting a little worried, and I was supposed to come over there that Saturday, so one of my cousins just told me, come over, just still come. And when I did come, I was still feeling kind of air because I had spoke with him. And usually, you know, I speak with him before I come, and he usually picks up. If he doesn't pick up, he'll call you back. You know, long and behold, though, when I got over that Saturday, I seen a ticket on his car, which wasn't good. Then I got a hold of his landlord, and they didn't have the key, but me and a landlord's wife went out to his car and looked at the ticket, and it was on Thursday about 9 something in the morning. This appointment was at 10. So that didn't look good, you know. He had to wait for her husband to come with the keys, and he didn't have the keys, I'm just thinking right there. He had to get a locksmith to open up the door, and about 5 weeks, if I'm not mistaken. You know, as a matter of fact, at this time last year, he was in the hospital because it was the 22nd of this month when I found him. You know, he never was able to come back, man. I mean, he was always a fighter, you know, and everybody knows him again. He was a fighter, but he just couldn't win this battle, you know, unfortunately. He had about 3 major strokes, and it just took him down. One took out his ability to move, the other one took out his ability to speak. I think another one took out his ability to swallow food. You know, to be back to like that, you know, those boxes right there. I knew he wouldn't want to live like that, you know. Still trying to keep him going until, just was any hope, you know, that the hospital that I'm staying in ICU for about 4 weeks, and then kind of took him off the, anyway, they left him on oxygen, they stopped feeding him through the intermediate feed tube, and they just put him in what they call palliative care. That's the hospital's official setting. And that's, it was a Sunday, Saturday night, I think they did it. I left that Sunday, I came back on a Tuesday. Went downhill, I mean, just that treatment for those 2 days, and I came back that Thursday, and I just told him to take one from the machine, you know. Wasn't too much of it to do, you know. All his friends, you know, that came by to visit him and supported him, man, I really appreciate it, you know. He had a lot of people that was pulling for him, you know, it just wasn't the beat, you know. I just want to go back, I'm going to wrap this up. When Bob was talking about that night at Smokes, I know he has been going down, and Steven talked about that too, that he was just, you know, declining. And when I took him home, he couldn't get out the car that good, and that kind of alarmed me. He had trouble lifting his leg. Matter of fact, get in the car. He had trouble lifting his leg to get in the car. But I've never really seen him with too many physical challenges, you know. Most of you guys know he was always in the health, always stayed on top of himself, you know. So those things kind of alarmed me, you know. Him not being able to raise his foot up to get in the car. Then when he get out of the car, he couldn't really raise his foot up to get out of the car. So he just had some physical challenges and some health issues. I believe he had high blood pressure, he was dealing with that, but he had some stuff going on with his kidneys. So he had a couple things going on with him. And he was 79 years old, still up and running, but you know, he was getting older, and unfortunately he just couldn't, you know, fight that battle, those strokes. It was 3 major strokes, and then come to find out it was 4 minor strokes all together. It was like 7 strokes, and the guy was still breathing on the floor, you know. I'm a missing man, I tell you, but I'm just glad that all you guys came out to support him. I'm glad of St. Peter's Church. I want to thank St. Peter's Church, you know, for putting on this event, Jazz Foundation for helping us out. Steve and Reggie, you know, put this thing together, you know, his countless friends, you know, that supported him, the musicians that's going to play tonight, you know, most of all the fans out here that's going to just enjoy what's going to come next, I guess. I want to thank everybody for being here. Thank you.
So if you talk on the phone like your dad, don't call me.
You saw on your program that said Cornelius, Sonny Fortune? Cornelius, right. Once in the 80s, Sonny had to go home to see his mother and take her something. I, you know, I was screaming. So I broke down with him, met his mother. I'm sitting on the sofa or chair or something in the living room. And she says, Cornelius, I can feel somebody's coming through. Sonny Fortune? Somebody else who can talk about Sonny Fortune is Reggie. Reggie, go on. We all know you.
Thank you. I started working at Sonny's booking agent in January 1997, brought on board by his then manager, Marty Kahn. It turned out that we were a good match. Sonny quickly became one of my best friends in this music that we love. We had a lot in common. Besides our passion for jazz, we shared a passion for boxing. Sonny and I watched big fights together on TV whenever we could, and sometimes in the company of Rashid Ali, who was also a fan. by legendary boxers and fights we haven't seen together, as well as anecdotes and stories about them. Sonny loved to tell the story of when Miles and Max got into a fight in Sugar Ray Robinson's club in Harlem when Sugar was out of town. When he got back and heard about it, he was incensed, saying, "What? They were fighting in my club? If I'd have been here, I'd have not closed the motherfucker." Sonny and I both had a philosophical bent, which led to many long phone conversations. I'm sure many of you here know what I'm talking about. Often the general subject matter could be summed up as politics and the state of the world. Sonny was an independent thinker and never followed any party line. He always liked to hear the other side of the story. And towards the end of his life, he regularly watched RTV to get the Russian point of view. Earlier in life, he was very active in the musicians' union, yet he took the union to task for not doing enough for the musicians. Sonny and I both felt that following current events today was kind of like watching a train wreck in slow motion. I'm telling you, Reggie, these were very interesting times we lived in. We had never seen anything like this before. And this was long before Trump ascended to power. Often he was referring to stories not in the headlines that illuminated just how those in power kept the deck stacked in their favor. Neither Sonny nor I had much faith in humankind to make collective decisions in its own best interest. It was no coincidence that George Carlin was one of our favorite comedians. Sonny and I were not technophiles. To us, the latest gadget was at best unnecessary and at worst a pain in the ass if it meant we had to learn a new way to do some everyday task. It was easy enough before, Sonny would exclaim, and I always agreed with him. Neither of us bought into the prevailing idea that technology is a panacea for all that ails us. Sonny applied his independent thinking to his personal health as well, plagued by high blood pressure that at one time spiked to over 300 on a tour of Greece. Sonny wasn't afraid to question his doctors and researched alternative means to get to stay healthy to augment the minimum in prescription drugs that he took. Like my wife Laura, with whom he would sometimes discuss alternative therapies at great length over the phone, Sonny was a fervent believer in nutritional supplements and took a lot of them. I joked that he and Laura should have a supplement off, putting all their daily supplements on the table and taking them one by one until the loser ran out first. In spite of our pessimism about the future of humankind and of the planet, Sonny and I were optimistic about our own lives. We felt fortunate to have people in our lives who we cared about, who cared about us, and who we could share ideas with and above all laugh with. We felt very fortunate that our work was something that we loved. Live until you die, was the motto we lived by. Music was a never-ending search for Sonny. Above all, he was searching for the perfect sound on each of his instruments. Energy and ideas were never a problem. If you played with Sonny, you better bring plenty of both or you get buried. For many years, Sonny would go to Rashid's place and enter what he calls the gym, where the two of them would play sometimes for 2 hours without a break. And I don't mean a bathroom or snack break. I mean, they would literally not stop playing for that long. Some of you may have heard that famous live dual performance of Impressions on WBGO, which lasted over an hour and generated a record number of phone calls. Sonny believed in his music and in his bands. Whenever I'd ask him how a gig went that I couldn't attend, his answer was always something on the order of, "We smoked the joint. I'm telling you, Reggie, this band is playing some hellified music. You gotta get us some more gigs." Sonny was old school in that he never bought into the current idea that the musician should promote his own gigs. He wasn't into social media. He felt that his job was to perfect his craft and his art, and it was the presenter's job to get people into the venue to hear the results of that quest. Inevitably, this meant that he worked less as he got older. He understood the changes in the business of jazz, but never expressed bitterness about it. And he wasn't afraid to turn the gate down if he felt the offer was less than it should be. "I'll stay home and watch Johnny Carson," he'd say, well into the 21st century. What Sonny could not tolerate was insincerity, or in his word, bullshit. You better be completely straight with him, or he'd see through you in a heartbeat. I can't remember the details of one such encounter Sonny had with one such person, but I do remember what Sonny said after recounting it. "Reggie, I just want my tombstone to say the motherfucker called an orange." So there you have it, Wayne. Now you know what to put on Sonny's tombstone. I'm pretty sure a photo of that at the tap will go viral. I love you, Sonny. I hope we meet again sometime, somewhere, somehow.
You mentioned that Impressions for over an hour on WBGO. That was an outdoor event in front of the Jersey Performing Arts Center. And I forget who the star act was, but Sonny and Rashid were opening. They those phone calls were about, right?
Like, what are you doing? I said, Sonny, why? He said, man, it seemed like a good idea.
And he said,
me and my sheep were like, man, wow, they took us off. Boy.
We're going to have some music coming up. Ronnie Burrage, Kenny Barron, and Joe Ford. But first, a word from the guy who's leading the band. Chip.
Ah, the bass player. Chip Jackson.
You know, it's really a privilege to be talking about Sonny. You know, just to say his name evokes pretty powerful emotional feelings. Just to say his name, Sonny Fortune, I mean, it's like saying, you know, Martin Luther King or, you know, Abraham Lincoln or something. I mean, you know, when you say Sonny Fortune, it's just very powerful just to say his name. And I always like to say he's in a special club, the club with Sonny Rollins, Sonny Stitt, Sonny Payne, Sonny Clark. He's like in a special Sonny club. He's a heavy-duty Sonny. And the first time I heard Sonny was in 1971 with McCoy. And I just couldn't believe what I was hearing. It was just awesome. And it's why I'm a musician today. One of the reasons why I'm a musician today, I was just hearing it and I was going, I want to do that. I want to go where they're going. And we launched into space. And Calvin was playing with him at that point. Calvin Hill's here. Coolest thing, I think. You know, when Sonny was in the hospital, I went to visit him. He was in a coma. And I have a brother who drank himself to death. And toward the end, he was in a coma. And he came out of it very briefly. And I said, could you hear me last week when I was talking to you? Were you in a coma? He goes, yes, I could. And then he went back in a coma. Mm-hmm. So I knew he could hear me. So I knew Sonny could hear me. So I said, Sonny, I said, you're a force of nature, man. I said, you are a powerful force of nature. His toes were exposed in the end of the bed, and he had socks or shoes on, and the sheet was pulled back far enough so his toes were exposed. And when I said that, I saw his toes move. And I said, you know what, Sonny? You need to get better, because I need to hear you play the intro to You and the Night and the Music. I don't know if you've heard that, but when he plays that intro on that G7 whole tone chord, it's just like Sonny all the way, man. You could hear that for like just that one intro. I said, you need to get better because I need to hear you play that intro. So his toes move. And, you know, I'm just going to say just a couple more things. You know, I played with Elvin Jones for 5 years, and we had a lot of good tenor players, Pat LaBarbera, Frank Foster, and Charles Lloyd. Nobody brought out some special shit that he brought out of Elvin. Nobody. When he played, something special happened. It was just incredible. And I went and got to stand next to him and in the band for the internet. Every single night I would go, I don't believe it. Next night we play and I go, are you kidding me? And then the next night we'd be like, really? I never got used to it. Ever. There's a video of us in Tokyo where Sonny plays Keiko's birthday march. It's the most swinging thing you know. It's just unreal. I'm so proud to be on that. And I just want to say something about Sonny that I thought was pretty funny. His sense of humor was priceless. It was really, his honesty and sense of humor. So when he joined Elvin, Elvin asked him to play tenor. He was an alto player. He didn't want to play tenor, but Elvin wanted to hear the tenor. So because he wanted to play with Elvin so bad, he played the tenor, but he hated it. And halfway through the tour, it was really kicking his ass. So bad that he even bent the neck. He was playing so hard, he bent the neck in Paris. He had to have a brace around the neck to stop it from bending. Yeah, this guy was just like, you know, going for broke. And at one point, it was affecting his play. It was kind of like, you know, a little bit, he wasn't really on his game because the tenor was really kicking his ass. So when I hear him struggling, I play like as a good bass player, I play really loud roots and fifths to like help him out. You know, like, hey man,
I got it, man. You know? Like, I don't even need a band. Like, I'm a bad mofo, and I'm out here, and I don't need you. And I'm just going to finish by saying, Jackie Williams came to hear us once, great drummer. He's got this really high voice, and I just love his voice, and he's got some gems when he talks about shit. So he came to hear us, and we're playing, and afterwards I go, Jackie, I'm so glad to see you, man, I'd love to see you, and what did you think? Did you like, you know, did you enjoy the group? You know, we were playing an outdoor game at the mayor's house. And he goes, no shit. I just love you and Sonny so much. He goes, you know why? Because with Sonny, it's all or nothing at all. And that's what Sonny was. I mean, he just went, and you know, I'm just going to very quickly say one more story. In Greece, we played a club that was pretty much a pickup joint. A lot of talking going on. And one thing about Sonny is that he would play to a certain level, and then he'd raise the bar. And then we'd play at that level, and then he'd raise it again. Each time he'd raise it, there'd be less talking in the club. And then he'd raise it a little less talking. By the time we got to where Sonny was really going for it, there was no talking in the club. They were stunned. They were like going, what? You know, they were like in shock. You know, it's like, what are we here? What are we seeing here? What are we hearing? It was fucking awesome. You know, so I am thrilled to have known this guy. And, you know, I'm just glad everybody's here too.
Within an hour or 24 hours, he would call me back. And that's amazing because there's people nowadays that you can't get them anymore. But I love him to death. He was an incredible person.
ship. It was so long, it was like the length of the song. Just talking about what Chip was going to do, listen, you're going to check out what he, oh man.
But you made it worthwhile when you started to play up there.
You might have noticed, if you have your programs, we're doing music from Sonny's CDs. And, well, this is, he was really proud of this, the bulk music that he did for Blue Note. Bruce, the president of Blue Note Records, himself called Sonny to ask, would you like to do something with us? And this was in, like 2003 or something like that. And Sonny was like, yeah. And he did some nice work. That's what they're going to play back from that CD. Ask me now. Most of you don't need a man as good as you are. Now, I don't know why anyone want a tennis saxophone on this, but this is a cat that can blow garden's way anywhere. And it's worth it. No saxophone. Odean Pope, who could not get here from Philadelphia.
Yeah, Odean and Sonny go way back, of course, to their Philly days. Odean has got a huge project coming up. He's writing like crazy for it. He said he originally thought he'd be able to get away, but he can't take the time off. But he wanted to write this for Sonny. Sonny Fortune, one of the greatest minds in this country, has produced. Blessed with charismatic charm, natural leadership, an infectious smile and laugh, and a tremendous sense of humor. The chord we struck when we rehearsed and recorded, giving form to the unexpected sensations. I miss the odd sight or strange sound. I can return to the day Sonny and I played Joy Spring in my parents' home, when my character suddenly grew a throbbing third eye. What brings me the most pain is characterized by his absence. The silence of his phone after he called me and I didn't call him back. I'll take this lack of sound as my opening image. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it drive like a raisin in the sun, or does it fester like a storm in the run? I could explore how his silent phone is like a blizzard, a glacier, or frozen lake. Or I could compare his silent phone to poker, our favorite game to play together. You either build or destroy. Sonny Fortune was a forerunner, and I'm blessed to have lived in his time. Thank you, Creator.
So we give you something different. NEA Jazz Master. Trumpeter Supreme. Jimmy Owens.
Decided to retire. They had a pension. They had money coming to them every month for the rest of their lives, and many times their spouse would get a sum of money every month after they died. That kind of stuff doesn't happen enough for all musicians. Sonny Fortune worked for many years, and he would lose his pension because he was not able to do what the American Federation of Musicians Pension Fund required. And he would have to start all over from the beginning. He did that saxophonist. They called him Cornbread. His name is Hal Singer. He lives in Paris, the outskirts of Paris. And when one time visiting him, he said, "Jimmy, you know, I have nobody to talk to. There's nobody to talk to." He says, "All of my friends are dead." Clark Terry told me the same thing. He says he had nobody to talk to. All the people he came up with were dead. Many of my dear friends. Larry Willis and I went to school together. He was 1 year ahead of me. It hurts. I want you to know that. That's the reason why I always play Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen. Because even when we're in pain, we perform. I had no idea 2.5 weeks ago. Rob Crocker and I were up to see Harold Mayburn. In less than a month, we lose 3 great pianists.
Thank you. and many times on intermission would go in the bathroom and practice until he went back on the bandstand. He was an incredible person, one of the most gentle men that I've ever known. And yet when he played, he would never necessarily come to that conclusion. At least when I used to see him, Coltrane was kind of crazy on the bandstand. But I had many conversations with him. I remember one time talking to him on the phone for almost 2 hours. And I kept asking him questions, and he kept saying he didn't know. And he was asking me, what did I think? And I remember saying to him, man, I'm not even thinking. I'm asking questions. I don't know anything. But he was a very humble human being, very dedicated to the pursuit of music. At least that was the impression that I got from him before I worked with people that knew him better than me. And years after working with all of those people, I can reaffirm what I thought of him in the beginning. Matter of fact, more so, because I don't know anyone that has anything bad to say about Coltrane.
First gig he got was with Marco Santoria's band. Eric was no longer playing in Mumbo's band, but he had me help all the rehearsals and recordings, and that's how I met Sonny. And we immediately became really good friends, probably because of originally our mutual respect and love for John Coltrane's music. I wrote some notes here that I referred to that I wanted to mention about him. We had a really good relationship. We spoke on the phone often, and really long, long conversations. I remember him really enjoying with his, he had a really hearty laugh, as you all know. I told him a story about John Coltrane, who he really loved, and who, matter of fact, he said that Coltrane changed his life. I told him a story that when I was playing in Mumbo's band, we were working in Pabst in Philadelphia, and that was actually about walking distance from the another jazz club, Cheryl. So on our intermission, me and a couple of the guys in the band walked over to the show. It was summertime and their door was open, and the closer we got, the noise was getting louder and louder. And as we got to the door, people were screaming. What it was is, it was a part of the show where Coltrane and Elvin Jones were just playing, the two of them, and they had the place in an uproar. We stayed about 15 minutes, and we had to go back to play another set, and the crowd was still roaring. Sonny got a real big kick out of that. Whenever, here's a cute little story. Sonny had an answering machine, and at one point, he had a message on it. I want to read what the message said. It said, "Hello, this is Fortune. To your misfortune, you've missed Fortune. Unfortunately, I have an answering machine that costs a fortune, so please leave a message." He said that Tain told him that if he ever got an opportunity to play with Owens, Jones, to take it. And sure enough, he did have the opportunity to play with Elvin and McCoy and Miles Davis. They all recognized how important he was, what an important voice he was. And I really miss hearing him play, and I'm sure that all of you who are there in attendance recognize how important he was to the music. And I really thank Steve Johns and Sonny's manager, whose name I'm sorry I forget right now, for putting on this memorial. He certainly deserves it. He's one of the real under-the-radar guys. And thank you for letting me be a part of it.
high school, my mother says to me, every day you find out something new. Sonny Fortune in a tuxedo? Oh, I never see that one. And Marty talked about the long phone calls. This was not Verizon days. These were the days of AT&T, but every minute cost you. So I imagine Sonny might have stopped in AT&T. But he did have a great drummer named Steve Johns.
Yeah.
So to speak before he plays.
Video together. He's a great bassist. We worked kind of worked on it this week. Anyway, I just want to finish. Really great to see everyone here this evening. Thanks for coming out for Sonny. It's an honor to be in such a great, with such a distinguished group of jazz artists. Wonderful gathering of people that love Sonny. I started playing with Sonny Fortune back in 1999, and over the years I got to know him pretty well. Sonny was such a dynamic force in the jazz world, as we all know. He was a true giant in the saxophone, and he was a great band leader. It was such an inspiration to play with him and the fantastic players he would have on board in his quartet over the years. He was also such an interesting person to be around. Always had stories to tell and, loved to talk, especially on the phone. We'd have long conversations on the phone. I mean, long conversations. So when I had to call Sonny for something like information for a gig, I had to find a half an hour in a day or so to do this. You couldn't just call Sonny up for a few minutes. Nope. That's right. Sonny was also a man of his word. I admire that in him. When Sonny said he was going to do something, he meant it. He expected the same from others, as we've also heard tonight. He felt someone was going to lift on him. If somebody was going to go left on him for, you know, run for cover, because Sonny didn't play then. He was an honest man, and he liked, he had your back, and he did. He enjoyed playing. I enjoyed playing with Sonny very much. When I first started playing his quartet, we traveled all around the world, but over the last 6 years, not so much, as Sonny became more and more frustrated with flying. One thing Sonny used to say, if you want to ruin your day, go to the airport. That always cracked me up, because it's so true, as we all know, especially JFK. Sonny's famous words, I'd rather drink muddy water and sleep in a hollow log. I love that when he said that. It cracked us all up. Also, I never got to sleep much after our out-of-town concert, because he wanted the first plane out. I want the first one smoking, Sonny used to say. Which made sense because he always got us home on time. Sonny also really loved New York City. So I guess he just wanted to get back to the crib. Anyway, I just want to say I've been really, really feeling the void as it's been a year since he left us. No phone calls, no interesting stories, no Sonny laughs. To end, I just want to thank Reggie Marshall, who was Sonny's agent for many years. Reggie was the one who encouraged me to help light the candle, kindling to get this memorial to happen. It should have happened sooner, but here we all are in tribute to the great saxophonist and the main man, Sonny Fortune. I know Sonny's smiling down on us. Lastly, I'd like to mention how sad I'm to hear of the sudden passing of the great Harold Mayburn, who was actually at Sonny's last pit at Smoke. Harold would have been seated somewhere here in this evening. Probably would have played. Rest in peace, Harold. Now, just over the last 72 hours, we have lost more giants on the piano first. The legendary Richard Wyons, yesterday the great Larry Willis. Rest in peace, you both. Anyway, I want to leave with the last voicemail Sonny left with me. I never talked to him after this message. Let me play the message. Okay, thank you, Sonny Fortune, and thank you, everybody. Here's the message.
I'm going to have surgery next week. I'm still walking out of the catheter. And
foot so close to the stage.
Reggie is a good manager. The CD that I'm going to be playing from, Sonny played flute on this particular song. And Cheryl's going to take care of it. Never again in such a long time. That was his last recording of Sweet Basil, which became Sweet Rhythm Down in the Village. Set that yourself. I remember you playing flute on that song as I was there. Okay, guys. Hang on. Thank you.
with you guys, all right? This is jazz, right?
I asked...
Thank you for the confirmation.
I've asked Emmanuel. You know the Zoom, can you do it?
As a young man, he said,
I don't really know him.
But after consideration, as a professional, he said, I think I can do that.
So, Emmanuel Owens.
Thank you.
Family playhouse in high school for us. Thank you so much for doing it. See ya.